Welcome to Monday Jazz and Conversation, presented by a collaboration of four nonprofit organizations: Gold Coast Jazz Society, South Florida Jazz, Sunshine Jazz Organization, and the Miami Jazz Cooperative, all of whom are dedicated to bringing jazz to South Florida audiences. Each Monday, Wendy Peterson and Nick Yorta feature the music and talk to the country's most talented and interesting jazz musicians.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome John Fedchok to the hang.
Hi, everybody. Great to be here.
The amazing and beautiful and the world's best person, Brenda Alford.
Hi, Brenda.
Live up to that.
Okay, I got some living to do.
Please welcome to Jazz and Conversation the amazing Joe Donato. Joey D. How are you? I'm so
good evening,
sad.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Ralph Edwards. And tonight, Joe Donato, this is your life.
And now, the hosts of Monday Jazz and Conversation, Wendy Peterson and Nick Yorta.
Here we go.
Hello?
There.
Okay, everything's good. It's always an adventure. Always an adventure. Welcome to another edition of Jazz and Conversation. I am really excited tonight because one of my favorite people of all time is here. She is the official... jazz fairy godmother, is that correct? The official jazz fairy godmother. And she's just one of the coolest people I know. She's the hardest working person I know, teaching and volunteering and giving of her time and singing her ass off and playing her ass off and coming up with unique ways of interpreting songs. And she really is just... she probably doesn't even realize she was a mentor to me when I first started out, but I used to show up at her gigs. I used to stalk her, basically, and show up at her gigs and just pray that she would let me sing in, you know, sit in and sing, and she always did. And I just, you know, I was like, laughed at every joke she said and, you know, was a big fan. So it thrills me to know and to present her tonight, but also to be her friend and peer and sister in song. But we of course are speaking of the amazing Nicole Yarling, Nikki with a K. And you have anything to say?
I'm excited. That's all I have to say about it. And I'm just taking care
just
of, you know, I'm always taking
out,
care of sounds.
You're trying to figure out stuff. She is joined today in the studio by the amazing Jim Gasior, who will be playing organ tonight. And so no bass player, just Jim's left hand. And
what a treat.
And John Yarling on the drums. So let's just kick this show off. And ladies and gentlemen, Nicole Yarling.
Good evening out there. I don't remember what day it was. I didn't notice what time it was. All I know is that I fell in love with you, and if all my dreams come true, I'll be spending time with you. Every day's a new day in love with you. With each day comes a new way of loving you. Every time I kiss your lips, my mind starts to wander, and if all my dreams come true, I'll be spending time with you. Oh, I love you more today than yesterday, but not as much as tomorrow. I love you more today than yesterday, but darling, not as much as tomorrow. today away. Cupid, we don't need you now, on your way. I thank the Lord for love like ours that grows ever stronger, and I always will be true. I know you feel the same way too. And you know, I love you guys, both of you guys, as much, but not as much as tomorrow. So we'll move right along with our show and review, I guess. This is fun, and I love this house. We'll do a song made popular by Miss Billie Holiday. I said that I thought this was really cool.
Jim playing organ. This reminds me of Harlem running around and going to jam sessions when I was a knee-high to a grasshopper. So this is really, really cool, the groove and everything, and I'm so happy to be here with my friends. All right, here we go. You don't know what love is until you've learned the meaning of the blues. Until you love a love you had to lose, then I'll tell you, you don't know what love is. You don't know how lips hurt until you kissed and had to pay the cost. Until you flip your heart and you have lost, then I'll tell you, you don't know what love is to lost heart feels at the thought of a reminiscence, and how lips that taste of tears lose their taste for kissing you. Hearts burn for love that cannot live yet never dies. Until you faced each dawn with sleepless eyes, then I tell you, you don't know love.
Thank you.
That's Jim Gasior doing all that stuff. I'm going to take a half a chorus and I'll sing it out.
Fun. It's really nice to do this. Man, I thank you guys for inviting us. Wow. So I think we're going to do a song that I wrote and called You Were Meant for Me. And it's kind of, I borrowed from a whole lot of sources. The West Montgomery,
Four and six.
And I was thinking of Janine, because I love both. So it's just a little up-tempo ditty with the help of Jim's left hand. I might be having to do that for the rest of the song. Here we go. You were meant for me, and I was made for you. Somewhere etched in stone, a solemn oath or two. Don't know what it is, I haven't got a clue. All I know is you were meant for me, and I was made for you. Birds have got to sing, the sun has got to shine. Go wandering, but you will still be mine. Maybe it's the faces doing what they do. All I know is you were meant for me, and I was made for you. Somewhere written in the cards, somewhere there among the stars, is a declaration of our love.
I don't know, put it there. All I know is I declare, you were meant for me and I was made for you. I was made for you. So love did it booty up, but it up to be a sin doodle. He had it, hey, had it, hooked it to be do the dead, do I? So that to be the day. He had the air, last time I saw Janine, she looked just like a royal queen. Ha la 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 la. How much is that doggy in the window? Sitting back. Somewhere written in the cards, somewhere there among the stars, is a declaration of our love. I don't know who put it there. All I know is I declare that you were meant for me, and I was made for you. I was made for you. Made for you. Made for you. Made for you.
Thank you. So, more?
One more.
Oh, okay. So, we're going to do... Okay. You know, I'm getting old and forgetful.
I said something because I had something in my head to do, and if Carol Ann Taylor is listening, you're the reason I'm doing this song. I heard the song, I heard you do it. I love the song so much, and I always did love the song, and was like, okay, so sorry, Carol, I'm borrowing this song. You kind of put your mark on it, but I want to do it.
What key that's in?
B flat.
Mm-hmm. A flat.
Is that what I said?
A flat, yeah.
Okay, then that's what I'll do then. When somebody loves you, it's no good unless he loves you. Happy to be near you when you need someone to cheer you. All the way taller than the tallest tree is. That's how it's got to be. That's how deep it goes if it's real. When somebody needs you, it's no good unless he needs you. All the way through the good old years and for all those between years, come what may, who knows where the road will lead us? Only a fool would say, but if you let me love. It's for sure I'm gonna love you all the way. And for all those in
some would make. Who knows where the road would lead us? Only a fool would say. But if you let me love you, it's for sure I'm gonna love you.
So talking to the mic when we talk to you now, but you're not going to hear it back.
Okay.
It's just like you're talking to us here as if you were at Wendy's house.
which you may or may not be.
Is this one of those undisclosed locations?
Yeah.
So, okay, I don't know where I am.
I honestly wish we could just skip the interview and hear you play more, but... Part of the whole fun of this is actually doing the interview.
Oh,
and
Lord, you're going to scare me. Y'all going to ask me to... You know,
what does Max think, though?
Let me just tell you. This is... I was worried that he might, knock over the violin, but he found a spot. He's good.
Max, I love you. No, it's funny because you know how you always see those bad sitcoms where, like, somebody comes on for the interview and, like, they go, but we heard you embezzled.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. We're going to find out the truth. We're going to discover things. But, you know, this is the one of the greatest things about the show is all these people that we've seen for years and years and years and years, we don't talk about this kind of stuff on our break. And so it's kind of fun just to learn your background and you know. Oh, so the first thing we're going to do.
I was born in Little Shack in Mississippi.
The first thing, where were you born?
Actually, Brooklyn, New York, Kings County Hospital.
Okay, so this is a picture of little Nikki, literally.
Oh, well, I see the picture. Oh, yeah.
You will see the picture. You are just adorable.
Oh, Lord.
And let's put the other one of your brother in you.
Yeah.
Oh, look at you. Your face. Oh, my God. Oh, that Lord. Smile of your brother's is something.
That his name was Byron, but I called him Bynin. Because I couldn't say Byron.
Oh, my gosh.
And my other brother, I don't have a picture. I had a picture of the three of us together. I don't know what happened to it. But I was looking real quick. So his name was Michael, but his name was Michael. And Byron was Bynin. So that's
so
what happens
you
when
you
don't have a T.
You had two brothers growing up.
I mean, there's other brothers and sisters, but you know, somewhere.
I don't want to look there.
Oh, all right. All right.
I want to look there.
All right.
This is not, you know, this is not the big time. This is just the, you know.
Please ask about the great violin caper when hers got,
pinched.
Oh, God.
Oh, that was terrible.
That was a story and made the papers and the.
That was, I mean, the most amazing thing when people badmouth Facebook. I just can't, you know, I love Facebook. But for better or for worse, I mean, and it was a former student from UM that actually, I came home.
Not that took your violin.
No. Okay. I came home and
First of all, let's just say, you went to Publix?
Well, yeah, I was on my way to WDNA.
Right, to do the
workshop, and I stopped to get some chips. I go inside, I parked in the same place I've been parking for 4 years, right? I go inside. I'm at the cash register, this is what's freaky, and I hear somebody say, red car. We gotta find the person that owns a red car. I own a red car. And I'm like, oh, I hope it's not me, right? So I get my chips, I go outside, and sure enough, the spot is just outside of that parking lot, anybody that knows that parking
lot. Right.
The guy apparently had followed me. had the same car that I had in another color. It parked behind me. And some woman, I couldn't script this better. Some woman was sitting in the bank drive-thru, saw him, took pictures of him.
Oh, wow.
Going from his car to mine, he took a crowbar, broke the window, and the idiot dropped the crowbar. Took what he could out of the front seat, because everything was on the front seat of the car.
Right.
Well, not everything. That's the thing, saving grace. So then he goes back, gets in his car, and drives off. I come out, and I'm like, oh, my God. So it was my violin. It was, like, about $2,000 worth of cameras. He took an amp. I had a small amp. Everything that was on the front seat of the car, because I was going to take that stuff in.
Yeah.
So, but here's where it gets even freakier. This really big guy, maybe like 6'2", 3", comes, and his name, couldn't make it up, was Angel.
Oh, wow.
And he was a security guard. And he was with his girlfriend, and they said, let's go get him. Now, what had happened was, this is what happened was, he missed my camera bag, I mean my computer bag in the back seat. So he took my phone, but my iPad was in my computer bag. So I was able to track him.
Right.
So he goes, let's go get him. And I'm like, I don't know you. I'm not going to get this. Very, very long story short, the guy went immediately, we found this out later, went to the pawn shop, pawned everything for like, I forgot, it was like $100 and something.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. So I have friends, my God. So I go home. And I wrote a rant on Facebook.
Yeah.
I was just, I didn't know what to do. I was beside myself. And one of my former students saw it. And I posted the pictures because the security guard, the woman that took the pictures, gave it to the security guard that worked at Publix. So he gave me the pictures. She took all that stuff, put it together, and made a flyer and circulated it on Facebook. It went to thousands, literally thousands of people.
That's when you like
that never
a virus,
happens. People
right?
read
Things
my post. Because everybody felt, they felt, you know, the same. They felt violated like I did.
Well, and also, I don't know if people don't realize sometimes, like, your instrument is like a part of yourself. You know, it is like a child or, you know, that, whatever. It really is something special. It's not just, it's irreplaceable.
No.
Yeah.
And the weird thing is I had gigs the next day and I had these old violins in the closet that didn't work very well. It was just a nightmare.
Yeah.
So Maggie helped. Maggie Pelea helped because she knew some of the local police. I had friends. People helped me come out of the woodwork. Anyway, very long story short, the detective called me in. He took a deposition. At the end of the deposition, this is really freaky, he goes, we have your stuff. Now, let me back up. Oh, I forgot. Rewind. There was a woman that knew the guy.
What?
She recognized the guy in the picture, and she reached out to me. We're still Facebook friends.
Yeah.
I found out this guy had a rap sheet. I found all this stuff. He had done a series of things, right? So she helped, too. So all these people came to, you know, they came to my aid, and it's just, I can't thank them enough. So I get my stuff. I had to go and pay whatever it was, $125 to get my stuff back.
Right.
And the guy never really, so he robbed me on Saturday. The police wound up calling me. For real. They're like, he did it again. I was going to go on it. So he went, there was a running car. He stole a running car. Somebody left their car took that. He went into a library and stole an iPad. The guy was, and I said this, if he was 16 years old, I might like gather up some people and sit down and try and talk to him, do an intervention.
Yeah.
You know, I don't see 16 years. But this guy was in his 50s.
What?
Yes. He was a career criminal.
Right. Oh, wow.
With a drug problem. And I understand that and I get it. But come on, guy.
Yeah.
And the police even said, there was no remorse. The guy had no...
He just needed to get a fix or whatever. Yeah.
Well, if you ever were wondering if the community really loves you,
There you go.
I'll tell you what. And I created an additional page with information about insurance and stuff.
Right.
Just because, man, wow. Yeah. I got big love for it.
Yeah.
And you love a happy ending anyway.
Yeah.
All right. Behind me. How did you get started?
Yes. In music.
I don't know. I don't know.
Was there music in your house?
My dad played piano.
Okay.
There was always records around my house. I played violin in school. But it was like, it was not the cool thing to do when I was like a teenager. Uh-huh. So I kind of stopped because my friends didn't think it was cool. And then when I got to college, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I always loved music. Music was always a part of what I did. It's just, you know. But I got the bug. I ran into some crazy people. Remember, I don't know if you knew Cynthia. She played flute.
Yeah.
All right. So she took me to my first jam session.
Wow. And were you singing at the time or you were playing violin?
No, I was playing. And here's how clueless I was. I went with an acoustic violin to a jam session. Actually, I think one of the first ones I went to was Salt and Pepper in the Bronx. Lou Donaldson lived down the street. Mm. Dakota Staten lived down there. All these people.
Wow.
And it was an organ club. And they had an organ sitting there and drums. And people would just come in and play. And who was the great... Don Pullen just stepped all over me. That was funny. I'd get up and try and saw. I didn't know what I was doing. Right? But I get up and try and saw with this acoustic violin and an organ trio.
Wow.
Organ duo, really. And they'd let you do it, and I got the bug.
Yeah.
And New York is great for that because if people see you're passionate about what it is and they hear something, they hear a drum of something, then they say, come on.
Yeah.
And that's how New York was for me. And, that's where I grew up. But
that's what you're doing here now.
Oh, man. That's why I do what I do. Because people said, here, come on.
Yeah.
We know you know nothing at all.
Wait a minute.
But you want to do this, so come on.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how it was. You know, we had Jazzmobile, which is, I cannot believe it's still in existence.
Yep.
It's almost 60 years old. The Muse, and all of these workshops, and all of these famous people were giving stuff away for, Jazzmobile was $15 a year. And all of those teachers, Steve Turay was teaching there, Curtis Fuller was teaching there, Billy Taylor was teaching there, Norman Simmons, who just passed away. All these people were teaching there for nothing.
Wow.
You know,
because
they had the love. Frank Foster looked at one of my arrangements and actually took it home and critiqued it.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's the kind of, that's why my heart is, you know, the way it is with young people and jazz. Because.
And how did you end up down here?
A man.
That's always about a man.
A man.
Mm-hmm.
And
man,
I told him
man.
I was coming down for a week. A man? A guy over there. It's his fault.
Well, I'm coming down for a week. I'm not coming.
Oh, we are getting dirt. I love it.
No.
Woo.
Well, we're going to keep it clean. But I got a great story about that. So I come down, and I had saved up, like, my little pennies. And we went to a place. Now it's so politically incorrect. It's amazing. Called Sambo's.
Right. I remember.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Sure.
That was in Coral Gables.
No, there was one on 36th Street. When you get off 95, right where the Taco Bell is, right there. If you got off Biscayne Boulevard, and right there was Sambo's.
Okay.
And John and I went in to get something to eat. And we had that little old white raggedy car. Remember that?
Dodge Dart.
And John, some of John's drums were in the trunk, but some were in the back seat. And for some reason, I don't know, the music gods had it. I took my violin in with me. I left my pocketbook on the front seat of the car.
Oh, my.
Needless to say, they broke in the car. They stole John's drums.
Oh, my God.
They stole my money. All the money I had saved.
I'm sensing a theme.
I've had more robberies in South Florida than I've
had in New York.
New York. I grew up in New York. Everybody goes, oh, New York.
It's because all the New Yorkers came down here.
They all came down to rob me.
Oh, yeah. Tell us how you started singing. Because from violin to singing.
Okay. See, he likes the dirt over here. So, all right. So, John and I were living together in Long Island City before I came down. And I was going to jam sessions, you know, trying to hone my little craft.
Yeah.
But I had the bug. I wanted to sing. But I was afraid. Hmm. And so, John left. And I was in the apartment by myself, and I was kind of practicing the song I was going to try out at a jam session.
Okay.
And I guess he forgot something. And he came back, and he stood outside the door and listened to me sing. And then he came back in and said, hey, you sound good. You should do that. I was so embarrassed. I was like, I don't know if I cried, but I was close to tears.
Wow.
For real?
I was really...
No. I said, I thought it was a recording.
I was...
And you know what the interesting thing is, Nikki, out of everyone that I know or I listen to or I hear, you have such a naturalness and just an authentic... something, it just feels like it just comes from, you know, like it's meant to be. You know, I love listening to you sing. So
I
thought,
love you.
You know, so thank you. If it was you that did that like, you know, shoved her out the on stage or whatever. But it's something special, really. There's something about your, it's like, it feels like Mother Earth to me when I listen to you.
Well, here's the thing that I'm really, really happy for about that. When I work with singers, not only with singers, when I work with anybody, any musician, and they're really insecure, I tell them about this from a real place.
Right.
You know, because sometimes people talk at people and say, well, if you only do this, then...
Yeah.
No. The palms of my hands would sweat.
Wow.
I'm not kidding. I would break out in this terrific, terrible sweat, and my hands would sweat, and I would shake, and I had a conversation with myself. I know that sounds weird, but it's the truth. And I said...
Well, if you can't talk to yourself, who can you talk to?
Self? I said, do you really want to do this? And I really wanted it.
Yeah.
That's how bad I wanted it.
Yeah.
And so, and I think of Ella, because I heard the stories, and John Levy, who was my manager...
Right.
Knew her and said she was really, really insecure. And so you hear these stories about Ella, but he knew this.
Right.
Ella would be on one side of the room and somebody would be having a conversation and she'd think they were talking about her.
Wow.
And she was really, everything I read about her and all the stuff that I've done, you know, these little things we do for school, you found out she was really, that's what she was always batting. She was sweating and she was really nervous. But she was so, so, so amazing.
Yeah.
But she had to get over herself.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So what was the first time you took that leap of faith and sang in front of people?
Well, it was here. It was in South Florida. I mean, I just remember going and I would be so nervous that I would sing so loud. I mean, I would eat my... it got easier.
Yeah.
And it's still not, you know, I mean, I'm comfortable.
Yeah.
But I think that came with age, because I think now it sounds terrible, but it's true. I don't care what people think about me anymore.
Well, that's the place of beauty. That's the place of beauty, actually, because when you stop worrying about what you sound like or caring about, oh, is this pretty or is this, you know, that's freedom.
Yeah.
That's basically, you're free to be yourself. You're free to just express yourself. Yeah.
I think John Levy told me something once, and I think it was him that told me. He said, you know, he said something to the effect of, just like presenting yourself and just saying, this is who I am. This is what I have to offer. I hope you like it. If you don't, somebody else will.
Right. And you'll find somebody else that you like, you know. Yeah. Yeah, it's the same thing. Yeah.
I mean, it's funny because I think back, you know, I know that there are people here in South Florida that remember me when I was really, really, really green. And they haven't seen me in years. And then they see me and they go, oh, you've improved. And I know it. They mean it as
over
a compliment, but it's kind of a backhanded slap upside the head.
Yeah.
You know, I work really hard at what I do. And it's not like I stop because I'm older and I feel, I still work at my craft. You know, it's a lifelong job of trying to be better at what
One
I
of
do.
The fun things about you is just these songs that you just pull out, you know, and the way you come you go about them, it's unique to you, and it's always extremely soulful.
Well, you do it too.
Well, yeah, but it doesn't mean I can't appreciate, you know. Seriously, every time I see you, even if you do the same song that I've seen you sing before, it never feels the same. It's always fresh.
Well, thank you.
I think one of the things I like about you too is that you always seem to be really enjoying yourself.
Uh-huh.
You know, no, I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's like there's a spirit of just, you know, like I'm having fun, not that I'm doing a show or whatever. You always just seem to really get into the music with that's contagious. You're like that with your bandmates and the audience.
Well, yeah. I love you for that. And here's fun. It's a funny thing. We talked about this over the years. When you do jazz, you see, I'm doing jazz now. I am presenting myself as a jazz singer.
Right, right.
This isn't me.
In all seriousness.
It's not me. And it's fake and it's phony and it's pretentious and it's not me. And I'm sorry, it is not me.
Yeah.
I am the same if I'm singing a blues, I'm singing a rock song. And to me, the joy of performing is becoming a kid and being okay and not worrying what people think. Or is my hair perfect?
Yeah.
None of that matters. Yeah. Because what matters in the long run is what comes out of my mouth or what comes off my instrument. That's what people remember.
Yeah.
They might say, you look really great.
Right. But you know what?
But I don't care about that.
The funny thing is, if you really think about it, if that's what they remember, you didn't really do your job right. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm really, really about, and I've always been. And what's more important to me is the respect that I get from you guys.
Yeah.
That's what matters to me more than anything else in the world. Because that's what I've spent my whole life trying to do, trying to make good music,
right?
Quality music. I think I'm pretty good looking. I don't think I'm hard on the eye. But, you know, it's not about what I look like. It's about what I produce.
Right.
And that's always been the most important thing. And when I hear musicians say nice things about me, that to me weighs... No disrespect to the audience. I need y'all.
Yeah.
I need you to listen to me.
Yeah.
But what the respect for my peers means more to me than anything else. Mm. And so...
Yeah. Well, we got some more pictures to go through.
Oh, Lord.
We can take a look at.
And I sent you some doozies, didn't I?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Why don't you tell us a little bit about all these great... by the way, you are also a person with various interests. You are quite a photographer, right?
Yeah.
Because you're always taking pictures, and it is scary because when you ask someone like Nicole, hey, can you send us a few pictures? She writes back, well, you know, she sent like 15 or 16, says, but I've got millions.
Oh, I have like about 12 photo albums, and then I have about a suitcase full, and I have all of this incredible stuff.
Yeah.
Well, so.
Well, here's some of the gems you sent.
Uh-oh, wait, what did I say? Oh, this is, and if you notice, I have one shoe.
Okay.
We went to the Kennedy compound.
Oh, wow.
And I kid you not, I had lobster lunch with Ted Kennedy.
Wow.
And his dog ate my shoe.
His dog ate your shoe?
No.
The dog took my shoe off the porch. We went out, for real, we went out on their their wooden ship, whatever it is.
You can't
it's
make
not
this
a
stuff
yacht.
Up.
It's a right. And then we had lobster lunch. I'm not kidding. This was when I was with Buffett, and I can say it because I know she's not listening. One of those people in the picture was dating Ted Kennedy. Oops. Oops. I won't tell you who. It wasn't me. Nice. So I just thought that was great. And I had forgotten about that picture, but that was the, we went to the compound. And he was adorable. He went out and got the Irish cook out of the kitchen and brought her in, and he was pontificating like a politician about how wonderful she was, and she was from Ireland. Mm-hmm. But it was cool. That was fun. That was a lot of fun.
Very nice. And so, here's with your group. Yes.
Ah, that's I put that picture on the
that's
on
the Stivers,
website. Yeah,
isn't
it? It is Stivers.
That's when we were in Europe. And the bass player, Gwen, did you know Glenn Quater?
I did not.
Yeah.
You know he's a conductor. John
I
said
didn't.
Some stuff. He's conducting. He's still playing bass, but okay. He's conducting. I mean,
he's in Baltimore.
Yeah.
Wow.
So he's pretty cool. And there's Glenn. I mean,
Ben Stivers.
Stivers, brain freeze.
Yeah, yeah.
Back
and,
there.
Look at John with some hair.
That's John mm-hmm. back there on the drums.
Mm-hmm. A little bit of hair.
Yeah, there's in some little teeny club in one of those countries. Somewhere in Scandinavia.
Right.
That was fun.
Well, would this be the same time? Because here's a picture from Denmark.
And quite wow. the picture. So I only included this picture.
Why?
Woo!
Because we had gone to... the first time we went to Norway, we were in Norway for 9 weeks riding back and forth
wow.
in a van. Hey, mm-hmm. So we go back the next summer, right? And we got booked on this festival. It was called the Midfin Festival. Now, I thought, you know, festival is going to be like, you know, a few hundred people
yeah.
with, you know, going, yay.
Yeah.
Drunken Danes, and I walked out on the stage. There were 19,000
wow.
people.
Wow! And you immediately proceeded to do a Miles Davis and play with your back to the audience. Is that what you did?
Well, the reason of this picture is interesting because the photographers were taking pictures, and I was my usual crazy self and saying all kinds of crazy things. And that picture wound up on the front page of the National Danish newspaper.
Wow.
And so for that summer, photographers were following us around trying to get, because that's a great shot.
It's
you know, it could be anybody.
Yeah.
I could tell you that somebody else, but it's me.
Yeah.
And somebody told me, I don't know how I found out, I was walking down the walking street in Denmark, and I got in a conversation with a total stranger who said that the poster was in a jail cell.
Well,
oh
now,
my God.
That's another story.
You didn't receive any collect calls?
I don't know who it was. And I never saw the person again, but that, yeah.
That's so, funny.
I just thought that was a great, you know.
That's a great,
it is a good
great
shot.
It's, to this day, people in Denmark do not know what she looks like.
No.
All right, here we go. Oh, so
here
the blue
you
note.
You're at the blue note.
That was a Monday night at the Blue Note. We got snowed in.
Ooh.
Remember we did? Yeah. And it was really cool. You know, I can actually say I played the Blue Note.
That's right.
And it was cool. It doesn't take a lot to pack the Blue Note.
That's true. That's the one nice thing about
it. It's a whole teeny place. But it was really, really cool. It was a nice, great experience. That was with, who was that?
Dan
Feisley.
Okay.
And John and Dave Siegel.
Okay.
And me. Yeah. And Regina Carter came out because weird coincidence. The week before, I did something for WDNA at the Coral Gables Congregational Church.
Mm-hmm.
And the very next night, she did something
oh, wow.
for Miami-Dade. And so we got to know each other, and she came out and we've been friendly ever since. I mean,
good.
she's very, very cool. She's really cool.
Very
so that
nice.
Was fun. That was fun.
Gate Mouth Brown.
Yes, Gate Mouth. Yeah. At Tobacco Road.
Oh.
And he always, yeah, he always had pot in his pipe. Yeah. And he was weird because he was playing and I walked up to him and I said, hey, can I sit in with you? He said, well, if you got the nerve to ask me, I guess I ought to let you sit in.
All right.
And then he stood there. I'm not kidding. He stood there. And once he heard me play, then he started playing again. But he
oh,
was
he
like,
wouldn't play until
he gave you the evil eye.
Yeah.
Did he?
Oh, yeah. Until she played.
But then he told me, he said something to me. He said, don't you ever growl when you sing.
Oh.
Wow.
He said that's kind of, I guess what he was saying was, you know, that's what people expect of black people.
Okay.
And so don't, and it was a really kind of a weird thing to say.
Yeah.
But I got it. I got okay. what he said. And that was really cool. And he was actually pretty cool.
Yeah.
He was nice. He was cool.
After all.
Yeah.
After everything.
Well, after you heard me play, then I was
then
okay.
Then you were okay.
Well,
sure. Yeah, of course.
I do like this next picture.
Uh-oh. I don't know what it is. Yeah, that's my crow
picture.
Oh,
my God.
That's my crow picture.
Yeah. Nancy Wilson in one door.
Yeah. It was at the Beacon Theater.
That's
and,
nice.
And she... it was an interesting night because it was hilarious. I'll humble myself and say this. It was a tribute to John Levy, and it was George Shearing, and I think Billy Taylor was there, and Shirley Horn, and Nancy, and Nat wasn't there, but who's the guy from lives in up the state. Trumpet player.
Yeah, Adderley?
No. As soon as I say his name, it'll come to me in a minute. Anyway, he was there in place. He was representing that. And so I came out. I was like the opener because all those other people were more important than me. So I came out and I was playing with Buster Williams, which was really cool.
Okay.
Playing bass. And I did my thing, right? But then Nancy Wilson came out. She did not sing a note. She walked out on the stage and got a standing ovation.
Wow. Hate when that happens.
But she actually turned out, that night she was a little weird. There was some weirdness going on with her, but she turned out to be very, very nice. And you know what's really strange? She had the same temperament to me as Alice Day.
Oh.
Which is really weird. Yeah.
Wow. Meaning what?
Just when if you don't know her, she comes across as
standoffish.
But then once you get to know her,
okay.
She's, you know, and so I didn't get to know her very well, but she, you know, I just thought that was really, really cool. Mm.
Very cool. So then you can go from
Nancy
to Joni.
Joni.
That was freaky. That was freaky. We were in New Orleans and with Buffett.
Okay.
And Joni Mitchell sat in with us. We were doing some event, right? But everybody else was like gaga over Joni Mitchell. And I was like, okay, I know Big Yellow Taxi. That's about all I knew. I didn't know very much about,
yeah.
Really. I mean, I knew her big hits and everything, but I wasn't, okay. So the rest of the background singer was like, oh, Joni Mitchell, right? So I'm in the tent, and nobody else is there but Joni Mitchell and I.
Wow.
Right.
So I go over to her, and there was a song she wrote called Cherokee Louise, which I found really, really, really interesting. Was about, and she told me the whole story. It was about a Native American girl who had been raped.
Mm.
And the whole
song.
So
a light song.
Huh?
A light ditty.
Yeah. So I really loved the melody of the song. And so I started asking her about it. We had the nicest conversation for 15 minutes.
Nice.
Just the two of us. I said, bye. And then I went and told them, hey, I'm hanging out with Joni Mitchell. But that was somebody who took that picture on stage. So
very
that
cool.
was really cool.
Very nice. And you clearly have worked with some of the great looking musicians in the business. like those two right there. I believe
that's the prettiest people in the world.
Yeah, and yes. when that's all you remembered for.
Well, yeah, I gave up trying to impress people with anything else. So
that's
so.
The Order Brothers.
Yes,
that was when we were working at O'Hara's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, good old days, huh?
Oh man.
And some more pretty people here. Look at that.
Yeah. I have a ton of pictures of Wendy. Remember the chick? That was a chick singer thing.
Oh, was okay. That on 8th Street?
Yeah.
I never went to one.
Never?
No.
Oh.
It was so cool.
Sorry.
No, it was really, really cool.
My
That's
loss.
Right, exactly.
I don't know who that's. Who's the person in the. Do you remember who that is?
I don't. No.
Well, there we go.
I don't know either.
Just thought we'd throw those in. So here we have Charles Neville.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was at Jazz Fest. And that was the weirdest band. It was two altos, obviously Charles and Amy. Harp, classical harp.
What?
Steel pan, two violins.
How did that never catch?
And what's it say?
Never caught on?
Who's a drummer from New Orleans? He's in New York now. Oh, God. Senior moment. Senior.
Perlin Riley?
Yeah, that's who was playing drums. Yeah. So it was a weird band, but it was fun.
Nice. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that I never wanted to go to New Orleans unless, I mean, I went a couple of times with Buffett, and John and I were talking about moving there at one point. We went down purposely the day after Mardi Gras.
Oh.
And needless to say, it was a graveyard. was a graveyard. But I said I never wanted to go to Jazz Fest unless I was actually playing. And that just happened. So that was fun. I have a recording of that somewhere.
Nice.
So that was cool. Fun.
Okay. And moving on here.
What else did I
say? Edda.
That was the same, that was the Beacon Theater, and that was one of my favorite singers, Etta Jones.
Mm.
One of the first people
I was going to ask you who your kind of favorite or, you know, influences were singing.
Well, I don't know if she was my favorite singer by default. We had a couple of records of hers, and that's who I listened to early on. So she was the sweetest person. I met her down here, too. Mm. And then I met her in New York. She was super, super cool. That was really nice.
You had a wide variety of interests then, growing up, yeah? It wasn't just like jazz and then you sort of isolated towards that?
No. I grew up, you know, just like the rest of us growing up, listening to rock and roll and Motown and everything, all kinds of soul music and all kinds of things. And I just like everything. And Wendy and I talked about this before. I love songs, and I talked to Jim about it.
Good music is good music.
Yeah. A good song is a good song. Mm-hmm. And no matter what you do, you know, I'm definitely not of the mind that when people say the Great American Songbook, it did not end, you know, with the Brill Building.
Yeah, in the 50s.
I'm sorry. So, yeah, that's...
That's Regina Carter, and the it was all string players.
How fun.
Next to her is Steve Torre's ex-wife, Akua Dixon. Her sister played in the Uptown String Quartet. She's really, really good violist and good improviser, really good. And that's me. And my other friend, Nancy, played violin.
Hmm.
And she still lives in Harlem.
And you toured with Buffett for quite a while. Yeah?
I think it was 3 years. Yeah.
Did you enjoy that?
Huh?
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, look. Do I like the freedom of sitting in the room with these guys and jamming? Yes. This is a show,
right?
Where you do the same exact things every night, but it paid really well. You get flown around in Lear jets for real. Buffett later on. Now Buffett, I think, flies the band. 5-star hotels, people, you don't lift anything. Everybody, you just walk out on stage. Yeah, I think I did like it.
Nice. Looking back.
Was John Lovell in the group back then?
John was.
Did he come in after?
Yeah, John. No, we were in at the same time. Okay. I think. Yeah, John came in and then I was there maybe a year. The first year he was there and then I was gone.
Right.
Tell him the Joe Walsh story.
Oh, what? Oh, he said something weird to me. He said something like, I don't remember exactly what it was he said.
Well, you called and said, I never experienced anything like this before, but when he started playing, it felt like...
Oh, that I forgot about. Because he, Timothy B. Schmidt, who was actually, he was really cool.
Right.
But Joe Walsh was on on stage. And you know how people joke about 11?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it was like 12.
Oh my God.
Got it.
Really, really amazing. God. So him and the Timothy B. Schmidt, that's my favorite.
Yeah.
He was on the other side of the stage and he's like looking at me. I'm like, why is he looking at me? Why is Timothy B. Schmidt looking over at me? And he's looking and looking. So finally he comes over and he was the nicest guy on the planet. His dad was a violinist.
Oh, okay.
Right? So
for the jazz fans, you might have to tell them who he actually is, you know.
Oh, Eagles.
Yeah.
And,
yes, Timothy B. Schmidt.
He was a bass player. He was, I can't tell you why.
He sang that beautiful song, yeah.
And so he actually knew, we had a mutual friend, Roberto, bass player who played with Warren Zevon.
Yeah.
And so when I got home, I made him a recording of a bunch of violinists. And he thanked me. He was really cool. He was absolutely cool. So that was just a nice...
And we've got one, of course, of your favorites.
That was very, very, very special. I mean, I'm so grateful for him. And he was just really, really, really cool. And you see Jeff Grubbs in the background, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, Jeff Grubbs.
And Dave Siegel and John. And yeah, there's
now
everybody.
Now you can see everybody, yeah.
And Henry Johnson on guitar. Henry was actually Donny Hathaway's last guitar player.
Wow.
And he's playing. Remember we went to hear Gregory Porter what's the incredible singer's name? I can't think of. Ramsey Lewis, and she came out and sang one song and got a standing ovation.
Oh, Lisa
Fisher.
Fisher.
Mm-hmm. Henry was playing with Ramsey then.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so he's been doing that. He's okay. This was weird because we were still doing like Art Deco. And, you know, we had one night we were playing and it was like 30 or 40 degrees outside.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. On Miami Beach.
Yes.
And like there were five or six people standing going, yay! They could go inside, right? So we had to play. And it was Grubbs was getting ready to leave to go to play with the Pittsburgh Symphony.
Right. Yeah.
And so
he still is now.
Huh?
He's still there now.
Yeah.
He still plays, yeah.
Well, we went into the studio and recorded with this combination of people.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you guys would even remember Joe Roland.
No.
Okay, Joe Roland played vibes. He played vibes with George Shearing. Oh. But he also sold me for years, I have a friend. And for 10 years, he told me, I have a friend. So he'd say, hey, Joe, we finally record. Oh, he was real gruff. Oh, I don't know if this guy's still alive. So he calls John Levy, who was still alive. Just passed away a few years ago. He was 99.
Wow.
And that was my introduction to Joe. John heard the music, really thought it was great, introduced Joe and I. And I played with Joe, weirdest gig, at a state fair on the west coast of Florida. Ah. It was weird, you know, really, really weird. But I'll tell you a quick story about that. So Mo Morgan, if you're listening, Mo Morgan had Mo Jazz, right? Yeah. And at the time, he used to play videos on the break. I couldn't make the story up. And one night I was working and I happened to be, I was in a conversation with somebody and I looked over their shoulder and it was Joe Williams, Peggy Lee on stage doing something. It was a tribute to maybe to Ella or somebody. And I said, that night, I said, I wish that were me. I couldn't make this up. Almost a year to the
day. Were you reading The Secret at the time?
Huh?
Were you reading The Secret at the time?
No, I was just, I looked at this and I said, they were at the Kennedy Center. I found out later on what it was. They were at the Kennedy Center. It was a tribute to Ella. And they were on stage. Wow. And I think they were doing All Right, Okay, You Win. And I saw that and I said, I wish that were me. And almost a year to the day, I was standing there on stage singing with Joe.
Joe, wow.
So I always say, never be careful of what you ask for.
That was your audition.
Yeah, of sorts, yeah. It really was. Because the Mills Brothers were on the bill, too.
Wow.
I got to meet.
Cool.
They were old. Yeah. Oh, and it was the youngest, I guess one of the youngest living members at the time.
Right.
So, yeah. So that was where we met. And then the last time I saw Joe alive was at Gusman Hall. Basie was in town and Joe did a guest thing with them. And Joe called and said, hey, I'm in town. Come down. And I went down. I was working at Mango's. And I ran down, ran home. I talked to him for about 5 minutes. He gave me a song called Take Me Home. And we talked. I was sitting backstage talking to the bus driver for the Basie band. And then I heard they said, hey, they're calling you. So I didn't expect to go out and do anything. I went out and sang. And it was nice to sing, you know, at home with Joe Williams and the Count Basie Orchestra.
That's amazing. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
And here's your group Strings Attached.
Ah, talk about Dave Einhorn. Look, there he is.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's at All That Jazz. And Dave called Debbie Spring, who I'm standing next to, and Ira. It was Ira's birthday. And I went up there because it was Ira's birthday and I had missed him at the Fish House. And so I said, okay. I was coming from Florida Memorial, somebody's recital or something. And I went up and somebody took that picture of us. So, yeah. And Debbie's around. Debbie's teaching and playing.
Yeah, I've seen her.
She's starting to gig again, which is nice, which is great.
And Dave's here, moved back, and he lives in West Palm.
Right. Mm-hmm. And you just mentioned this gentleman a little while ago.
Yes, I love Gregory Porter.
He is like butter.
Yeah. Well, I was in my car going back to Jersey, and I'm in the car. And it's one of my stories, I'm in the car. I'm driving along. Gregory Porter had smoke. The car just turned around. It wasn't me. And the weird thing, the really freaky thing, was you never find parking in New York. I found a parking spot literally across the street from Smoke.
Wow.
I go across the street. Who's standing outside but Gregory Porter? So I told him my story of how I was driving to school and I heard the first recording. And he said, oh, I get that a lot. We were joking about it. So we're standing there talking and stuff. And I said, he said, oh, my drummer's from Florida. Oh, okay. And I look in the window, it's Andrew Atkinson.
Right.
Oh.
I
did not know he worked with him.
We saw him a while ago, and he said he was in the B band.
Yeah.
So it's so funny.
Okay.
But he worked with him at Smoke.
Yeah, yeah.
So
nice.
I went in, and I had a table, and I could look up his nose hairs.
Ooh. Nice.
And I took a bunch of pictures, and it was hilarious because the bar was lined up with women, and they were all like, ah. And I got some great pictures of
it. It's the hat.
From that, from
it's
there.
The voice,
and Smoke
I think.
Is real teeny.
Or the voice.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we have one more photo here.
Oh, okay. So I didn't know who he was. I had no idea who he was. Howard Duberly works at WDNA, and he's Jamaican. And so a lot of Jamaican artists come through. Maxi Priest came through one day. Ooh, okay. We took some pictures with him, and we were doing a workshop. Mm-hmm. This is a grandson of, this is Skip Marley.
Okay.
And he came in, and he was, you know, he hung out with the kids. The kids knew who he was. I'm old. And he was a sweetheart. So that was just one day at
WDNA.
Nice. WDNA.
And then, of course, we have one more.
I did lie. It was one more. This is
because this is my favorite.
Was that not the freakiest thing? Oh, my God. He was the sweetest man on the planet. Whew. Oh, my God. Oh. And that's Shaneri, and there's Noah.
Yeah.
You see Noah?
Noah.
Yeah.
He seems like the nicest man.
He's wearing the vest he's wearing. Some Native American guy was there and gave him the vest that night. That afternoon.
Yeah.
What happened was Pam Dearden said, oh, Yo-Yo Ma's here with the Silk Road Ensemble.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
wow.
And so I bought the video and I show it to my students in my world music class. So she said, oh, come bring your violin and jam with him. I'm like, oh, yeah, sure, okay. Mm-hmm. So he comes on the bus, and I stopped and I said, hey, you know, talking to him, I say, I show your video in my class, blah, 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 blah. He was very nice. So I go inside, and then I'm standing there with Pam, and I said, no, I'm not. I got in line, I'm standing there with Pam, and it's like, no, it's not my evil twin. You know, he laughed. And then later on, you know, everybody's like nudging me to get the kids to play for him.
Right.
So, you know how people kind of half-heartedly listen to people because they think they have to?
Yeah.
He took a chair and he sat down and closed his eyes and listened to a song that Shaneri wrote and Noah played.
Wow.
And I stopped and I said to him, look, you know, thank you very much. And I said, you know, you're a guy that's at the top of your game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't have to do this. I said, but the thing that I love and respect about you most of all is that you're always looking and always stretching. And he said, and I hugged him and he was really cool. And yeah, so
ta-da, fantastic.
That's my Yo-Yo Ma story.
So we have one last thing.
Okay.
Somebody that listens every week and watches the show every week reached out to us and said this was his favorite clip.
Philip Lakowski, who's watching now.
Philip Lakowski says, this is my favorite clip. So we took a little excerpt. We're going to play for it. And you're going to recognize a lot of players, and you'll recognize this just period. But you can watch. So we're going to play a little excerpt of, well, you're going to see it.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was Dan
Thank
Warner,
you,
Julio Hernandez, Albert Lee. And who was the drummer?
I don't remember.
It was a bald drummer that plays a lot with, I looked it up the other day.
Was it Keith?
That's fairly famous.
Yeah, it was, but I can't remember who it was.
I know, I looked it up the other day.
That was for an instructional.
Yes, exactly.
But you know what, Wendy? Thank you for being pregnant.
Why?
Because the only reason I'm there is because you were...
Nuh-uh.
You were with child, yes.
Oh, I didn't even know that story.
I know.
Hysterical. Damn you! Oh, that's
yes.
hysterical.
You were very, very pregnant.
Yeah, all right.
Yes, I love you.
Good work.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. That, well, you, I mean, you're like queen of that, of, you know, you, nobody sings blues better than you Yeah.
Wow.
But funny, right?
Yeah.
And that's funny that, I mean, Phil reached out to us and he's like, please, if you could, please, you know, play this because.
Oh, my yeah. God. Yeah. I love you, Phil, if you're listening, man.
He is listening, definitely.
Well,
wow.
Before we bring you back to perform a little bit, you do want to mention something.
Yeah, I do
right?
want to do this. So we always want our musicians to get paid, always, always, always. And it's really important for us that you support the musicians. This is like a gig for them. I mean, they've spent hours and hours setting up and sound checking and all this stuff. So if you could support the musicians, all you have to do is text the word tip jar to the number 44321. And that is the word tip jar in the little message section, like if you were going to say hello, instead of saying hello, you say tip jar. And the number that you're sending it to is 44321. The first $100 will be matched. And at the end of the night, the musicians get the money and they get paid. So please, as one of my favorite things you used to always say when you were selling your CDs.
I was going to say, my children will have
your
oatmeal.
Your children will, yeah. Just caught the end of the clip. Was that Russ Kunkel on drums? I don't think it was Russ Kunkel.
No.
It wasn't Russ Kunkel. I'm going to look it up. I swear I looked it up the other day.
I honestly don't remember who it was.
I was going to say Danny Gottlieb.
It's not Danny Gottlieb. I'm going to look it up during your song.
I'd be curious to know who it is.
But, she used to say, like, on her gigs when she was selling her CDs, my children need shoes. My children need
Please help my children that I don't have.
So please, I'm going to put this back up. Please, definitely, if you can, we love showing the love to our musicians. So support them. Text the word tip jar to the number 44321. You receive immediately a message back, which is a secure link to be able to either use PayPal or your credit card or whatever. That's just a little bit of housekeeping. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let's do some music.
Okay. Right. Let me just say one thing really, really quick.
Say whatever
First of all,
you like.
Again, I love you guys and you know that. You know this from my heart. You know you're my buddies. This was really, really great. And when you asked me about gathering up pictures, I said when I came in, I forgot how much I've actually done.
Yeah, you've lived. Lived the life.
If I never do another thing, and this is not jinxing myself, if I never do another thing in my life, I've lived a lot of, I've done a lot of amazing things, and it's all because of music.
Yeah,
you know,
that is true.
And
you know what I'm realizing, and we didn't even touch this, but how, you know, you've done a lot of amazing things, and you've traveled, and you've played, and you've done this, but you know, what I really think of you now within the last 10 years is as an educator and a mentor. And I don't know if you want to talk just a few minutes about that because, you know, it is really important.
Oh, yeah. You were just doing some student jazz jams recently, weren't you?
For, you know, with Gold Coast. One Sunday at Blue Jean Blues with the kids.
Right.
And went really well. Those kids were all Dillard graduates, and they're all at Manhattan School of Music on a full ride, you know. And the kids that have come through the organization that Wendy and Jim helped to start, because, you know, I don't take credit for stuff that I didn't do by myself. Wendy and Jim helped to start the Jazz Education Community Coalition. And Rita Quintero gave me that really long name. Thank you, Rita. The thing that I want to say really quickly about that is the cool thing about this organization that sets us aside, apart from other organizations. There's lots of great organizations that work with kids, but the two things that we offer that no one else seems to offer is nuance and opportunity.
Surely.
We offer the things that you can't get in, you know, you don't have time. Jim does this at New World. He has time to do this, you know, to work on nuance. The things that really help to shape music and make kids musical. But I have that opportunity with all these amazing musicians from the South Florida community and people that pass through town to come and work with the kids and give them the things that you're not going to get in a classroom, conventional classroom. That's one thing. Mm-hmm. The other thing is opportunity to
perform.
Put this stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's what that is the thing that is the hardest to do when kids are learning, to be able to, for them to be able to make the mistakes. You know, that's where you learn the most is by making, you know,
exactly.
getting out there and making mistakes and learning from those mistakes and trying again and trying again. And a lot of people, if you're just practicing in your room, you don't get that opportunity to get out there, step on it, and then, you know, and then try again. And that really, it makes a huge difference.
Well,
I can remember all the times that we were able to, you know, have the kids play in front of concerts, you know, at South Florida Jazz. And you know, it really makes a huge, huge difference.
Well, yeah. I mean, how do you get better at something?
Yeah.
You have to fall down.
Yeah.
You have to make
Yes, you have to practice, but practicing by yourself in a room does not do it. Exactly.
And people don't mind seeing kids go out and kind of fumble.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
True.
They see them and they feel their hearts. And that's what I was saying earlier.
And
about
especially
being a big
if they see them improve. Like,
yes.
You know, it's kind of like they actually get to witness the growth.
Well,
they get to witness the whole thing, which is fantastic.
Well, the amazing thing is Ian Munoz came through the workshop.
That's right.
Connor Munro came through the workshop. Anthony Hervey played with us.
We were just talking about this. Lisanne's watching. She says, thank you, Nikki, for sending me a couple of your kids to my new She Jazz project.
Well,
love them.
But these kids have a sense of maturity, musical maturity, that you may not even get until you get to college.
Right.
You know, and that's what's really, those are the things I can't explain to people when I ask for money.
Right.
When I write these grants, I can't explain to people
what they're getting,
what this is.
Yeah.
And I, you know, it's mind blowing. The kids that have come through the workshop that are now full ride at universities or they're, I didn't do it. All I did was give them opportunity.
Well, that's a big deal.
You know, but yeah. So anyway, I guess we should be playing.
Yeah, I want you to play. Yes, yes, yes. But well, I just wanted to say it.
We have a guest that I want to thank.
Yes.
And I want to thank Mac.
Oh,
Mac,
yes.
For joining us.
Mac, you can see Mac at the end there of the sofa.
Max? Anything?
Sorry, I was calling you Max. Sorry.
But it's Mac, like the knife.
Oh, Mac.
Like the knife, okay.
Mac, like the knife.
Apologies.
You know, he's sending you love. He's sending the good vibes, you know?
Mac's bored by our conversation. Sorry, Mac.
Mac.
No. Oh, man.
Nicole Yarling.
Oh, Lord.
Once again, John Yarling and Jim Gasior.
Thank you guys for listening. What are we doing?
Shoes, tiny little boxes.
Okay, I got all kinds of crazy music. So, all right, so let's do, you want to do shoes?
I do.
Okay, so you saw a picture of one of my brothers. My other brother, his name was Michael, as I said, Michael. And he was a big black man, very big, like 6'2" and big. And he and I used to argue all the time about, he'd say, you don't understand, you're not a big black man. And I went, whatever. You know, we would argue. So when the whole crazy social climate started to happen and things started to kind of get out of control, I started to notice that the police, the people that the police were taking down were big black men. So I said, okay, Mike, maybe you were right and I was wrong. So this song
is co-written. He's no longer with us, but this song was co-written by Michael Reed. It's called Shoes of a Black Man.
You guys got it. I don't even know if I'm going to play on that. We're crazy people.
Now it sounds like hey baby. All right, check it out. You know my brother said he told me, you just don't understand until you walk the mile the way that I did in the shoes of a black man. He told me many times over and over, I just couldn't understand. I never walked the mile the way that he did in the shoes of a black man. Yes, we would argue for hours and try to make him see that it was all his crooked thinking and not reality. Now I'm the one that's got twisted, and now I understand. 'Cause every day I walk a mile in the shoes of a black man. Hey, 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 the shoes of a black man. The shoes of a black man. Yeah! My brother said he told me, you just wouldn't understand until you walked the mile the way that I did in the shoes of a black man. He told me many times over and over, I just couldn't understand. I never walked the mile the way that he did in the shoes of a black man. Yes, we would argue for hours, trying to make him see that it was all his crooked thinking and not reality. Yeah. Now I'm the one that I got it twisted, and now I understand. 'Cause every day I walk a mile in the shoes of a black man. Hey, the shoes of a black man. Could be the shoes of a gray man or the shoes of a gay man. The shoes of a woman, the shoes of a brown man, the shoes of a yellow man, of a green man, hey. The shoes of a black man, the shoes of a black man, the shoes of a black man. So I figured that song could work for anybody these days that
are going through stuff. You know, we don't know what it's like to be gay, to be black, to be a woman, to be whatever. Anyone that's going through something that socially is an issue, a problem.
Oops, don't want to lose that. It's cool once we understand.
I'm doing a concert in September called Voice of a Nation, and I'm looking for songs. And I sort of have a list of some songs that I'm going to do. And this one came to me, actually, I didn't know it was in a television show. Yeah. It was Weeds. I didn't know that. And I heard the song. Harry Belafonte put together a compilation CD a bunch of years ago, and I heard the song there, and the original version of it is kind of like this. But I love the idea of the song, so I said, well, how can I mess it up? So I made it kind of a blues. Let me just get it in my head. We're in F, right? Hey. Boxes on the hillside, little boxes made of ticky-tacky, little boxes on the hillside, little boxes all the same. There's a green one and a pink one and a blue one and a yellow one, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look the same. All the people in the houses all went to university where they were put in boxes, and they all came out the same. There's the doctors and the lawyers and the business executives, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky. And they all look the same.
Bye.
on the golf course and drink their martinis dry. And they all have pretty children, and the children go to school, and the children go to summer camp, and then to university, where they're all put in boxes. They all come out the same. And the boys go into business and marry and raise a family in boxes made of ticky-tacky. And they all look the same. There's a green one and a pink one and a blue one and a yellow one, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look the same, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look the same.
Why such a weird song?
And I heard her sing it. I was kind of not the.
I want to talk to you about that just for 2 seconds. Can you make that happen?
Ooh.
I can't. Okay.
Hold on.
Okay.
Okay.
Because you know, I've heard this song many times, and it's like a novelty.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a novelty song, but putting it like that,
mm-hmm.
it really changes the whole idea of it, and it just makes us sound pathetic as human beings. You know, this idea that we're all going to be in boxes, and we're all going to look the same, we're going to dress the same, we're going to act the same, we're going to eat the same foods, and we're going to do this, and we're going to be the same, and if you're not the same, you're...
That's why.
Yeah.
Because...
But you don't think, like, I've heard that song many times, but until you did it in this way,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it really brought, I mean, so it's a silly song. It is. But you know what? Treating it in that way, it's deep.
She was in a car on a road trip home with her husband, and the song came to her.
Who is this? She?
Her name is Melvina something or the okay. other. And it was weird because I'll write it in the notes to the program notes when I put this thing together, but it was the point. Like, we live in a cookie cutter
yeah.
world, and that's the point she was trying to make. I mean, I know it, ticky tacky,
yeah.
it's almost yeah, yeah. silly to sing.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, it's yeah. like we all goose step. We're all step,
well, when,
stepper
when,
wise.
Well, it's funny because every time you do a new verse, when you come to that line and we all look the same, it just is.
Cause it, yeah.
It's like, you know,
Well, that's, I'm looking for songs that makes sense and really kind of depict who we are as a culture.
Yeah.
That I haven't been done like 9,000 times. Now, it's been done, but it hasn't been done like this.
Right, exactly.
And that's kind of, I'm about to, Jim's going to kill me because I'm about to destroy Big Yellow Taxi.
Nice.
Oh, wow. Not tear it up. No. I love the song. Not yeah. because of Joni Mitchell reference, but... I love the song, and I love the fact
the
that
idea of it.
It's yeah. exactly, you know, Walmart.
Yeah, right.
I even wrote a verse yeah. about Walmart.
A paradise, put up so, a parking lot.
Sorry.
Exactly. All right, that was, I just wanted to put my little 2 cents
I
on
love
there.
It. See, you and I can sit here and go on. Bro.
I know.
What do we have, one more?
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, you can do two more if you want.
Do you guys have a request or something that...
Do you want to do something?
I so adore it. But what do you guys think? What are you thinking?
You can do both.
And what are you thinking?
Well, he worked on that one.
I know, but what were you thinking?
Oh, Belle.
It's about you.
Oh.
You want to do Big Day, I'll text you.
Well, all right, so we have that. Was there anything else on my list? I know. See, this is typical.
And the other one that you sent, the Mr. Pate.
I'm going to save Mr. Pate's song.
If you want to save Mr. Pate and you want to save Donnie.
Okay. I'll promise I'll try not to step on it because it's such, I have such a great love for Donnie Hathaway. And Jim wants me to do this song. I'll do it.
Do you want?
I just, there's certain things. It's like Dinah Washington. There's certain songs. They just feel like if I do them, I'll do it. Okay.
Hey, just wait and see someday. Tonight, when you cuddle up and hold me tight, start
the Late Late Show. Hear the crazy music in the trees. See the flowers dancing in the breeze. Old Man Moon begins to glow. He's joining in the Late Late Show. Birds that should be dreaming started chirping their song. While fireflies are gleaming, we kiss, kiss on and on. Then we ever back to my front door, say goodnight and then we kiss some more. I guess you know I like you so. It started at the Late Late Show. I guess you know I like you so. It started at the late, 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 at the Late Late Show. Thank you, Wendy. Thank you, Nikki. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, John. Thank you, audience.
Jim Gasior, John Yarling, Nicole Yarling.
And Mac.
And Mac.
Don't forget Mac.
Sweet little face.
Thank you, guys.
Oh, thank you so much. This was so much fun. Just want to let you know, once again, there is still time if you, Phil Lukowski says, guess the dog likes Jim on the organ. And a lot of people have been loving on your organ tonight. I'm just gonna leave it there.
Including Matt.
Including Jim.
But once again, I do want to just say that support our musicians. If you liked what you heard, I feel like tonight was such a special show, learning, like hearing the stories and just getting to hear you sing. It's been so long and it's been so fantastic hearing you. Support our musicians. Text the word tip jar to the number 44321. And at the end of the night, we will give them a whole pile of money, hopefully. Oatmeal for all. Anyway, also, we want to give a big, big, big shout out to our wonderful partners in crime in this adventure that, we started during the pandemic. And we could not do this without the Sunshine Jazz Organization. Big, big, big love to Sunshine Jazz.
I think we have something
that's right.
Theirs real quick.
Let's see what they've got cooking up.
Sunshine Jazz Organization is proud to be presenting world-renowned steel pan maestro Othello Molino at weekly Sunday Jazz Brunch from noon to 3 p.m. at KC Healthy Cooking, located on a spacious outdoor patio at 11900 Biscayne Boulevard, serving an excellent gourmet Caribbean menu and great jazz, led by Lloyd Hawkins and Ted McDermott. As Alice Day would say, hope to see your face in the place.
Going on every Sunday at the Jazz Brunch. Also want a big shout out to the Gold Coast Jazz Society. They're going to have a full regular season coming up this fall, so we're really, really excited. But they've also got this, so watch.
They're back live.
They are back live, yeah.
Hello, I'm Pam Dearden, Executive Director of Gold Coast Jazz. We're live on Thursday, July 8th at the Bailey Contemporary Arts Center in Pompano Beach for A Taste of Jazz with Martin Hand and Friends. Wine tasting begins at 7 and jazz at 7:30. Seats are limited, so get your tickets at eventbrite.com. See you there.
I love hearing that. See you there. That's so fun to be starting to do live shows again. It's really, really, really exciting. And of course, Miami Jazz Cooperative. These are all the websites, sunshinejazz.org, goldcoastjazz.org, and miamijazz.org. Go to their websites, support them. They do such great for the community and for jazz especially. We can't thank them enough. We will have a lot of really cool things coming up for the rest of this month. Next Monday at July 12th, we will be featuring live Tom McCormick. And he's a great saxophonist and just a great guy and really a really fine, fine musician. So that's going to be a lot of fun. The Monday after that, July 19th, we are celebrating Matt Bonelli. He is retiring from Miami-Dade College, and we are going to, yeah, crazy, right? And so we are going to celebrate him. So listen, if you're out there, you have a story about Matt, you have pictures of Matt, send them to Nikki. You know, find us because we're going if you want to send a video of yourself saying congratulations or dishing dirt, a great story that you know, send it because we are going to be celebrating him and it should be a big
party.
And
I believe he'll be performing.
He'll be playing some live, we'll be talking, we'll be showing pictures, we'll be doing this whole thing once again. And then the last Monday of the month, we are going to feature Leonard Rutledge live. And that's going to be really exciting because he is smooth, and such a great guy also. So lots coming up. We hope you stick around, and we hope to see you next Monday night. And until then, have fun and stay safe, and good night.
Good night.